Haven is the story of a couple living and surviving together on a deserted planet. You play as Kay and you, or perhaps it is more accurate to say that you play as the relationship between these two characters, as you spend the game making decisions for both characters to strengthen their bond after making the radical decision to flee their homeworld. It is clear from the outset that this couple has been together for years. They are passionate towards each other when the mood strikes, but most of the time, they are companions. They support each other emotionally, but also pragmatically, by helping each other achieve the various goals they set for themselves, and engaging in each other's interests and hobbies. I saw so much of myself in Kay, and of my fiancé in you, that it often teetered on the bar between uncanny and even downright creepy. Which is a good thing. It was true to life. It is also a philosophically curious game, giving space for the characters to just sit back and vibe, inevitably letting the characters' minds wander to deep philosophical topics played in both serious and goofy tones.
You know, that is one nice vehicle.
Of course. I'm the one who built it.
Do you still consider this the same nest as the one you fixed up as a teenager?
What do you mean?
Well, we just changed the engine hood.
I just changed the engine hood.
Yes, okay, you did. But this isn't the first thing you've changed on the nest. And I hope it isn't the last one either. So, my question is, at what point does the nest, the one at the beginning, stop being the nest? Was it the first time you changed a part? Or will it be when you replace the last original part? Assuming you haven't done so yet. Does it happen sometime in between? Afterward? And even then, before you fixed it up the first time, all the spare parts that would eventually make up the nest, were they already the nest?
What about you? Are you still... Your body cells are constantly renewing, aren't they? Ever since you were born? You probably don't have that many cells in common with the K from the beginning. Actually, you two may not have a single cell in common. So, are you still K? I'll let you ponder that one. K! We need to go home now! You can think about that tomorrow, okay?
For anyone who has studied philosophy for a good length of time, you know that there's plenty of room for leisure and humor when trying to discuss the deepest ideas of humanity. And in that sense, it is honest to the process of what it means to study philosophy as well. Just before the events of the game, Kay and Yu crash-landed on this planet called Source when fleeing their home planet. But after a sudden tremor leaves your spaceship battered and broken, your daily goals shift to exploring Source in order to fix up your ship. While exploring, you discover an odd red substance that's polluting the lush blue-green environment and turning the cute, friendly creatures of this world hostile. Lucky for us, our energy resource, called Flow, dissipates the rust and cures the animals. You, as an engineer, wants very much to fix the ship. Kay, as a biologist, desperately wants to heal the environment. In pursuit of these two goals, whenever we do something to strengthen our relationship, we gain experience points, not just in coordinating combat, but in finding new places to explore, finding new foods to share, finding new ways to flirt, and of course, getting wasted together. As you and Kay's relationship strengthens, they talk about their pasts to learn more about each other, their worries, and it is through this that we can fluidly glean what sort of society the couple fled from. It starts small but quickly grows our appreciation for the kind of dystopia that was left behind. The matchmaker, an entity that assigns you a romantic partner for life when you come of age. Recalibrating, a technology designed to help trauma victims by erasing the harshest parts of a given memory, but in practice, can be used to erase so much more. The Council, A governing body with a history of colonizing other planets, assimilating their societies, and creating a second-class citizen through the use of marks on the skin. Most of these horrors are presented as being in the past, but only just. A clear and poignant reminder of our own history. Older generations still remember what it was like and are willing to embrace the council and the matchmaker's current abuses of power so long as they can maintain this new, somewhat more peaceful status quo. That's the kind of place the apiary was.
Do you remember why we climbed up here?
Because we're allowed to do absolutely anything we want.
Okay, but wouldn't we be a lot better down there, in the grass? This really isn't very comfortable.
I like it here. You can feel the nest purring underneath.
The only person in the world who prefers the sound of an engine to silence.
On source? You bet. Think about it. We would probably get arrested on top, just for doing this. You know, what's it called? Indecent exposure.
Not on truth.
Really?
Nope. As long as there's no deliberate intent to provoke.
And how do you determine whether or not there's a deliberate intent to provoke?
That is the question.
Anyway, we get arrested on truth just for being together, so I have no idea how anyone can live like that with all of those restrictions. Don't love each other. Don't walk around naked. Don't drive over 800 lum an hour.
You're confusing things. You can't just reject every law.
Wanna bet?
One needs laws as a foundation for a society, if only to protect the weak against the stronger.
As if that's what laws are for.
That's what they should be for.
I'm just saying, there should only be one law. Don't do unto others as you wouldn't have done unto you.
What if someone still does it?
They get punished.
Would you like to get punished?
Okay, two laws then. One, don't do unto others as you wouldn't have done unto you. Two, except if they break rule number one.
Watch out. You're on the verge of writing a whole constitution.
Blah, blah, blah. No, but seriously. Everyone knows deep down what is or isn't good.
Is that your conclusion, after observing the apiary?
All right, sure. But in the apiary, people aren't free to do what they want. And that's why it makes them frustrated, angry, self-centered. But if everyone in the world were as free as we are, as happy as we are, don't you think the world would be a better place?
I don't think that's possible. The main reason we're happy now is because we weren't before. If we had had this from the beginning, we would have probably found other problems, such as the fact that the nest's roof isn't at all comfortable.
Ugh, you have a real issue with freedom.
As the apiary becomes more and more aggressive in trying to neutralize us, sending armed hornet drones to either capture or kill, Kay and you start to have misgivings. Neither you nor Kay would be able to survive on their own, within their own limited skills. We were able to find our freedom, but only by joining together and supporting the relationship. So what right do we have to be the only ones to go free?
What are you thinking about?
Why'd you ask?
Dunno. You seem sullen. Was it not good?
Yeah, of course it was good. You were in the front row, you should know.
So, what's up? You seem lost in your thoughts.
I'm sorry, I was thinking about the apiary.
Of course.
No, that's not what I meant. I was just thinking, there has to be others, right? Others like us, who love one another, trying to escape the matchmaker.
I'm sure. So?
Well, I was wondering, shouldn't we, like, help them? Send them a message? Tell them about Source?
And how would we do that?
I don't know. I'm hypothesizing.
I'm just saying that would be the quickest way to attract more attention from the apiary. Being a fugitive is one thing, but bloot stirring is another.
I agree, but if there were more of us, we could be better organized, resist better.
Aren't you okay with just me?
Yeah, of course. But why should I, we, have this kind of luck? Just because you had the nest? Just because I had the coordinates to source? Whilst others in the apiary are forcibly matched with people they hate.
I know the feeling. But there comes a time when you have to think about number one. I'd love for the world to be rid of the matchmaker too. For everyone in the apiary to be free to live with or love whoever they want. But if I could press a button that would solve all of the apiary's problems in one go, and pressing it would even run the risk of losing what you and I have together, I can guarantee you that not only would I not press it, but I would rip out the wiring.
It just doesn't seem fair.
You think it's unfair that we got lucky and others haven't? Then enjoy your luck. Don't squander it. It's the least we can do for them. They would do the same if they were you. And they would certainly not press that blutin button.
You may be right.
I hope I'm right. Because if I'm not, that makes me a blutin monster.
The cutest of monsters, though.
Shouldn't we find a way for other people, people who want to choose who they love, to reach Source? Shouldn't we find a way to change the apiary so that those people don't have to run the way we did? Many of the conversations between the couple affords them the opportunity to speak in a way that makes them feel more confident about their relationship and their choice to escape, which prepares the couple to make an important decision. They form a plan to sever Source from the apiary before the Council can come and erase the life they have built together. But to do so, they must risk their lives to destroy a massive interplanetary energy source, a risk they are only able to take if their confidence in each other has grown enough. Haven is, above all, a story about love overcoming impossible odds. But philosophically, their love is antagonized by the idea of freedom. Haven's story recognizes that humans are social creatures. We are both individuals with specific and independent desires, yet in order to survive and thrive, we must embrace relational bonds. To be free to express ourselves, we must be free from certain social bonds. However, it is equally true that to be free to achieve some goals, we must have some of those social bonds. In rejecting the will of the society we came from, Haven asserts a rejection of the social contract. The social contract is a class of philosophical ideas about how societies and governments start, happening alongside the humanist movement during the late Renaissance, early Enlightenment era. These thinkers would lay the theoretical framework by which modern representative governments would form.
Life in the state of nature is solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short.
First articulated by Thomas Hobbes, the social contract was a retreat from the chaotic and warring state of nature. But on Source, nature is more cooperative. U and K retreated from the social state in favor of a state that more closely resembles that nature. They retreat from society to demonstrate that what is natural to humanity is instead united and loving.
For in all the states of created beings capable of laws, where there is no law, there is no freedom. John Locke.
John Locke's idea of the social contract presented that people would accept a government only if it were an egalitarian arbiter of life, liberty, and property. Yet U and K rejected this notion of the social contract too. Everyone in the apiary was assigned a partner by the matchmaker in the same way. But that equality was not enough for us, because it fell below the minimum bar, the humanist right of choosing who to love.
Whoever refuses to obey the general will be forced to do so by the entire body. This means merely that he will be forced to be free.
Rousseau's formulation is perhaps even more aggressive. With a focus more on collective will, the decisions being made by a whole society, and giving no exception to the natural liberty of individual rights. Yet K and U deny the collective will of the apiary by forming a society of two, dedicated entirely to the support of each other's individual liberties. Haven rejects that people have any obligation to the norms of a society for simply being present in that society. Moreover, it is in the bonds that we choose for ourselves that we gain freedom. Bonds based on our phusis, on our nature, on what is natural and true, like love, are the only obligations. Bonds based on our phusis are true freedom. The game also has a number of smaller vignettes that express some pretty poignant ideas. One at the end is a discussion of the grief felt when the person you lose is at a distance, or not an active part of your life.
Someone's thinking about the apiary.
Huh? No. Well, kind of. But kind of not. I was thinking about us. What we've done.
We've severed a balloon flow bridge.
Yeah. About that. It's like the biggest decision I've ever made in my life. By a very long stretch. I thought I would feel changed. Like an entirely new person. But no. I'm not feeling any different. Mentally. I mean, I don't think I've taken it all in yet. You know, it's kind of like when someone you don't see much dies. You understand it, you accept it, but really, concretely, it changes absolutely nothing in your daily life. The only difference compared to before is that you wouldn't be able to see that person if you wanted to. And you really don't remember they're dead until you want to see them. Right now, it feels like the entire apiary is dead. Even if I wanted to, I wouldn't be able to go back.
Does that make you sad?
It doesn't make me anything. Sad, happy, nothing. You know, I don't think it's hit me yet. I'd like it to stay that way, actually. I really hope it never hits me.
Will you tell me if that happens?
Who else could I tell?
What about your skin? Does it still hurt?
No. I can barely feel it anymore. I don't know if it's the Lufacrid oil, or if my immune system has just accepted it, but at least it stopped stinging. It feels better. It feels okay.
Still haven't noticed any superpowers? Remotely controlling the rust, making flow appear out of your hands?
No. I'm just super ugly.
This hit me very hard. I am sure that all of us who have lost someone to this pandemic would be able to understand. But before leaving you, I want to discuss the relationship between the Game Baker's previous game, Furi, and Haven, since it appears that the themes of freedom are in conversation between these two games. In my previous video on the philosophy of Furi, we discussed how each of the bosses in the game represented one of the justifications given by society for the prison industrial complex. But when we finally break free, our presence on the planet was directly harmful to the plant life around us. In Haven, before the final scene of the epilogue, we can return to our home islet to instead fill the land with flowers. In Furi, the writer made a choice to prioritize the value of life over his own personal freedom. Bondage was forced upon the writer, and thus he was also forced to choose between the value of life and the value of freedom. In Haven, we now see this dynamic inverted, because K and U asserted their choice to be bonded together, they did not have to sacrifice either value. Their bond gave the couple freedom, and with their freedom, they made new life, a new home, a Garden of Eden. a big thanks to the Game Bakers for another amazing game. I really look forward to seeing what they have next. Thank you for watching, everyone. If you enjoyed the video, make sure to hit the like and subscribe buttons, as well as ringing the notification bell so that I can see you at the next one. And as always, stay true. Thank you.